Buonasera a tutti. It's a big pleasure to welcome to the Consulate General of Italy in New York our very important and dear Luca Maestri and Maria Teresa Cometto for this evening of getting together about Italy innovation, about the strength of our top Italian managers who are having such a big success in the US. I really want to give a very warm personal welcome to Luca Maestri to this room which we call Piazza Italia. This is the room where we always welcome the President of the Republic, the Prime Minister of Italy, where they come here, and also we welcome the many times the young people, young Italians in New York, the new Italians as we call them, the new migration. So in a way, if you allow me, for us to welcome you here, it's very natural because you are a VIP and you are a young manager, young talent. So I think you combine all the things we want to do in this very room. So Luca, you are the CFO of Apple. What shall I add? You're the CFO of a big empire. Oh, I think you were just saying, telling us before, controls nearly 1% of the world trade. The figures of your company are comparable to many countries, many European countries put together. So you have the power and the influence of a governor of a big central bank. And in many ways, in the European media, they compare you. Your influence is compared to the one of Governor Mario Draghi of the Central European Bank. I think that you have brought to Apple your Italian genes, that's undoubtedly. You have brought your Italian education, you're a product of the Italian schools, of the famous Italian Lycee, as many of the people who are in this room were having a big success in New York. And you have brought also, of course, your big university career. You are a Lewis graduate, and we all know here there are many Lewis graduates. We know that, and we are supporting a lot this growing international side of the Lewis University. And let's say that in a word, you have brought to Apple and to all the other companies you work for Italian culture, Italian style of life, the Italian soft power. And that leads me to say that you are the kickoff personality of a series of interview conferences organized by the director of the Instituto di Cultura, Professor Giorgio Van Straten, and the interview will be made by Maria Teresa Cometto. There will be several of them in the next month. And let me especially thank our director of Instituto di Cultura because one day he organizes a conference on Italo Calvino on his famous memos for the next millennium. By the way, there is one about lightness that I think we should organize a conference in Cupertino next time because I don't know why, but maybe all of you agree that we associate lightness with Apple. And then the next day you organize a exhibition on paintings of Venice and of Italian design. You're very active in the enlightened role, I think, is contributing to promote here in New York a contemporary also picture of Italy, of how it is. We are a big country with a big past, but as I like to say every day here and every night, we are a country with a big present and with a terrific future. And precisely because we have a big past, we are better equipped than other countries to live the future. So I think these conferences will help also to strengthen these concepts. And last but not least, let me stress three things that I think could be very important tonight, and I'm sure that they will come out from the interview. You are Apple, you are innovation, and I think that the choice you made, Apple, last year to invest in Italy, in Naples, is an expression of how much you believe in Italy as an innovation country. So I'm very happy that you are here, that you will be able to explain through the help of Maria Teresa some aspect of this choice. The second thing I want to stress here is that, well, you are at the Italian Consulate General of Italy in New York. It's like the city hall for the Italians in New York. We issue passport, documents, certificates. It's not the only job we want to do. That's why you are here. That's why we organize many conferences and we want to open the doors. But what we have in common with, if I may say so, with Apple is the obsession for quality, for customer care, for the users. I think, and maybe they all agree, that we have still room for improvement here at the consulate, but be sure that we have, like you, the same obsession for quality and for giving services to our clients or users. I read a fantastic interview you made with an Italian newspaper where you say that you are an empire of services and you were focusing on the concept of service. And third, last but not least, I think I'm particularly proud that you are here in this room because another common concept of our action here is try to show, to display to all our community, to our dear New Yorkers friend, how much the Italians who have key roles in the US, in New York, have a very high sense of their civicness, of their being Italian. And you are maybe the first of all of them in this interview with La Repubblica. You said very beautiful things about the giving back to Italy, about thinking maybe in a future to have roles in Italy. I think this is very important because it means that we have this very bad and unfortunate expression, cervelli in fuga. No one is escaping Italy. You have Italy inside, and we are very proud of that. Thank you, Luca. And I think without further ado, I don't want to spoil the evening. We have to begin, and I'm sure that the interview will be brilliant. And be sure that here the audience is hungry and foolish to listen to you and to learn from you. Grazie, viva l'Italia, viva Apple e viva New York.
So I want to thank Consul General Francesco Genuardi for the brilliant introduction and for hosting the kickoff of this series of conversations. And I want to thank the director of the Italian Cultural Institute who asked me to help organizing this series. I'm very excited and very honored to do this. Luca, first time we met, it was here in New York. You just joined Apple from Xerox. And you told me, first thing I will do in Cupertino will be to put a machine for making Italian espresso coffee in my office. Did you do that?
Can you hear me? Yeah. Because I did that in a number of places. I left Italy back in 91, so it's, you know, fortunately I'm dating myself. And I lived all over the world, and I learned very quickly that truly there is something very unique about Italian coffee, because as soon as you cross the border, the coffee tastes different, right? I mean, it's amazing. I used to work in Switzerland, and I would drive up from Como into Chiasso, and if you have coffee in Como, it's a different experience than having coffee in Chiasso. And this is true all over the world. So I started putting these coffee machines inside my office because I wanted to have coffee. And I realized very quickly at Apple, and this tells you a lot about the culture of Apple, that actually I didn't need to do that, because if you come to Apple, you get the best coffee, Italian coffee, that you can find in the US. The person that manages our food services is an Italian person that came in, that you know, Steve brought into Apple back in 97, so he's been running all our internal restaurants and all food services for 20 years, and the quality of coffee, we got an Italian gentleman that goes all around the world to pick the right blends of coffee, so we're in good shape there. I didn't have to make that investment.
That's good news. Yeah. Talking about Italians at Apple, I heard earlier that there are many Italians in many different departments. Yeah. How come?
Well, I think Apple really is big on inclusion and diversity, and it's something that again, Steve promoted from the very beginning. Steve was a son of immigrants, and so there's a long history there. And so as you find Italians, you find really every possible nationality that you can think of. And obviously, Italians are, and maybe at some point we're going to touch on this, but I think the Italian education system is excellent, is absolutely world class. And so almost naturally, Apple has attracted a lot of great people in every aspect of the company, from engineering to sales to marketing to finance, some of them at least, not necessarily yes. me, but yeah, so it's a very open culture, very, you know, that really values diversity. We believe that having as many perspectives as possible within the company is going to allow us to you know, make better products.
Talking again about your life in Cupertino, I read that you get up, you start working at 4:30 a.m. Yeah. What time do you finish, and how do you survive?
Yeah, well, I think the survival part, I think, is an easy one, because I think you find out that man is truly a creature of habit, right? So if you told me 20 years ago you need to wake up at 4:30, I would tell you, no, that's not me. I cannot do this. And then once, for whatever reason, for whatever the circumstances are, you know that you need to get up at 4:30. You get used to that. I get to, you know, 10:30 p.m. and I'm completely wiped out. Yeah, at that point, my wife has a collection of pictures of me laying in bed with my iPhone, completely asleep. Something like this, completely asleep, or, you know, trying to watch a show and, you know, it doesn't even start and I'm already gone. But my boss wakes up 45 minutes before me, so I cannot complain. Yeah. Yeah.
Talking about your iPhone, which apps do you use the most for work and for pleasure? For
you know, it's very interesting. I was thinking about that a few days ago, and I think what the apps that you have on your iPhone screen are kind of a mirror of your life, because you realize very quickly that you don't want to have an app that you never use, and so you end up putting the apps that you use the most in the front page of the iPhone. And so for me, it becomes, you know, work apps. I use the Bloomberg app a lot because it gives me a lot of you know, real-time information on financial markets. Sports, because I like to follow sports, so I got all my sports apps from ESPN. There's a good Republic app that, you know, keeps me up to speed on the soccer scores so it's that stuff, right? And then I'm not in social media at all, so I don't have a Facebook account, and I must be one
is
of the very few people.
Is it forbidden, or you don't care?
No, I don't. No, nothing is forbidden at Apple. But no. I mean, but I don't have a Facebook account. I don't have a Twitter account. I have a LinkedIn account by pure coincidence, because I was one of the first people that signed up to the service when it was really, really small, through a friend. And so, in general, I'm not big on social media, but, you know, finance apps and you know, my sports and you know, Open Table, this type of things, right?
You mentioned sports. I read somewhere that if you didn't work in the tech industry if you had to choose another career, you would like to be a sports writer, journalist. Why?
Because I personally think I would be very good at it. I really think so. The people that know me well, they always tell me that I'm, you know, sometimes I'm too humble. But in this case, I know that I would do a good job, because I've learned over the years that there is an incredible correlation between the passions that you have and the success that you have in life are what you do, right? I think if you're passionate about what you do, the likelihood that you're going to be good at it is incredibly high. And I've always loved sports. It's this combination of loving the, behind any kind of sport, it's not only soccer, but behind sports, there's a lot of great stories, human stories, right? What happens and why people become, you know, the best athletes in the world and so on. And there's also the statistics part, which I like because of the numbers element. And so this interaction between the human aspects of sport and the statistics of it has always attracted me incredibly. I grew up reading, you know, Gianni Brera's books and so on, which is just a bit more than just, you know, telling a game, right?
Mm, so it could be a second career for you, maybe.
I wish it was the first one, but yeah.
Can you tell us which soccer team you are a fan of?
A fan, I think, is a very, very mild word, and so it's a bit more of a religion than an interest. I follow a team that tends to win quite a bit. So
the Juventus, yeah. Right? No. So you have something in common with the director of the Italian Cultural Institute. Okay, so you graduated from LUIS, which is an independent university in Rome, with a bachelor in degree in economics. And last year you were recognized as the alumnus of the year of LUIS. How has your Italian education helped you, your career?
I was, you know, I think I was saying before, I really believe, and I particularly say with the, for the young generations here, I really believe, and you know, I've worked literally all over the world. I worked here in the U.S., I worked in Latin America, I worked in Asia, and in many European countries. I am absolutely convinced that Italy has a phenomenal education system, and I think people come out of the Italian school system extremely well prepared. I did, after finishing LUIS, after a couple of years, I did a master's in science of management with Boston University, which is a great university. But frankly, I didn't feel that I was learning at a different level. I was kind of repeating what I had already learned at LUIS. And so I think it's a huge asset. People come out very prepared, especially if you come with a combination of a business degree and maybe a classical education, because again, you combine more scientific issues with, you know, an education that is rooted in culture, and it really allows you to think about problems in a very broad way. And so I really, of all the issues that you can be worried about in Italy, I think that the education system works very well. What lacks in Italy, and I'm speaking about my experience 30 years ago, I suspect it's not changed very much from what I hear. What is lacking is the linkage between the academic world and the labor market, which is where the U.S. does by far the best job in the world, right? And so I think creating this interrelation between, you know, what you learn at school and coming out of with a university degree to getting into the labor market, that's something that needs to be worked on in Italy.
You graduated 30 years ago, you said. What about today, young Italians? You meet young people from all over the world. How do you compare skills and attitude of young Italians to other young from?
My experience is relatively limited because the young Italians that I meet are kids that have made some very important decisions to come and study here, or, you know, take on an international career. So I probably see a sliver of the entire Italian population. And again, I would tell you, the guys, you know, the Italian guys that I meet are as capable or more capable than anybody else. And again, I think it's because of the very strong education system. What I worry about, looking at the Italian context, is this concept that every now and then transpires from discussions that you have and from what you read, which is the concept of rassegnazione, you know, being resigned to the fact that the opportunities are not there. Because I think young people need to understand it's truly much easier to have these global opportunities today than it was 30 years ago. The internet has really made the world flat, and if you have the ambition and the willingness to take some limited amount of risk, the opportunities are there. And again, the foundation from an education standpoint is there. And so I think that's what we need to fight to avoid this resignation in the Italian system.
Yeah, you mentioned that you lived in many countries besides Italy and the US, Switzerland, Poland, Ireland, Singapore, Thailand, and Brazil, I believe. How do you adjust your life and your family's life to so many different cultures?
Well, it started off that it was clearly one of the things that I wanted out of my professional life. I wanted to see the world, and even before, you know, the type of job, right? I mean, I was very drawn to this idea of exploring different cultures and understanding how, you know, people thought about life in different countries. And so I actually requested to be sent around the world. And so when I did it by myself, it was extremely easy. And my wife had, when I met my wife, it was the same concept. She really liked this international experience. So for us, it was a great pleasure to go all around the world. And then when we had kids, it's become progressively more difficult, right? And when they were young, we moved them from, you know, Switzerland to Brazil, back to Switzerland to Germany, and then to the US, and that was easy. Now, if I were to tell my kids, particularly my daughter, that, you know, we're gonna move from California, that would be a revolution right now, right? Complete revolution. And so I'm not even considering that. But it's every time a young person asks me, I always tell them, if you have that opportunity, you should take it, because it really, I felt for many, many years, and I worked for General Motors for 20 years, I felt that just going into a different environment, it really opened up your brain, right? It really, really forces you to stretch yourself in a way that living always in the same environment doesn't allow you, right?
How old are your kids?
13 and 14. 13 and 14, yeah.
So you and your wife, which policy do you have about technology and children? Have you set a limited time, for example, to use their iPhones, iPads? What do you do?
You know, I shouldn't be saying this given the company I work for, but I think when you have the experience at home, you think, oh, maybe it's just my kids, right? And then you talk to anybody you talk to. That's the reality that parents have today, that, you know, these devices are absorb so much of kids' lives that it's a bit of a, it's a challenge to set the boundaries, and especially kids get very, very aggressive in a way that we've never been that aggressive with our parents, right? When you try to take those devices away. So we have, and I think this is a very common experience, that everybody has the same problem, right? And my wife, that is, you know, the smarter person in the family, came up with this idea that, with this product that exists, which is called Circle, which is a small box that you buy, and then you put all the devices that are on your home network on this, you know, home network, and she can, so we don't need to go and take the devices away anymore, but we pause them on Circle. And so when we say, okay, we're gonna pause you now, this is, you know, when they get very hostile, but it's done in a very humane way, so they don't kick us anymore, and, you know, that's, the boundaries are very difficult to set, right? Fortunately, you know, they go to school, so for a few hours in the day, they're not glued to the screens.
Yeah, you mentioned that you worked for 20 years with General Motors, so you are an expert in the auto industry. What can you tell us about the future of cars in terms of shared mobility, autonomous driving, electric cars? I'm not asking you about the iCar, Apple.
I think you're the expert, because I think you've really summarized the three fundamental things that are happening in the auto industry that are gonna make it very different. You know, when you think about how people are gonna experience the car 15 years from now, you have to believe that it's gonna be a very different experience with the product than you have today and you've had for the last 80 years, right? It hasn't changed very much. The reality is that the purchase of a car is the second largest purchase that you will ever make in your life beyond purchasing a home. But the reality is also that you use your car less than 5% of your time. And so it's a highly underutilized asset that is very expensive to keep. And therefore, when you think about shared mobility, and what's happened with Uber and Lyft here in the US, and there are equivalent services all around the world, when you think about the possibility that there is no longer, one day there's not gonna be a driver in the car because it could become autonomous. Also, just a change in the powertrain between, you know, the combustion engine and the electric engine. These are fundamental shifts, right? And I already see, for example, the young generations in a place like San Francisco, where shared mobility is readily available. I don't see the same desire to own a car that we had when we were 20, 21, right? And so I think it's going to be different. How different, I don't know, but the things that you talked about, I think, are going to be the big drivers.
What about your Xerox experience? When you worked there, the company was trying to change from its traditional business, the famous printing machines, to the new digital products. What did you learn from that experience?
Well, I think Xerox is a great, you know, a great name. It was, you know, back in the 80s. I mean, it was one of the most innovative companies in the world.
The Palo Alto Research Center,
which is still there, by the way, and still owned by Xerox. But it tells you how, you know, a company needs to adapt, because what works today is not necessarily going to work 20 years from now. And Xerox, for example, did a better job at transforming itself than Kodak did, because Kodak actually ended up going bankrupt. And Xerox, you know, through this acquisition, which now they've unwound just about 6-9 months ago, they basically spun off this outsourcing business that they purchased. But it really gave new energy to the company, because it really forced them to think about the business model. And now it's very interesting, even after they've outsourced this IT and business process outsourcing business that they had acquired, even the traditional business has now turned into, instead of being just technology sale, it's also what they call managed print services. So they manage all the printing that goes around in the different companies. So I think it's very, very important. It really taught me that, you know, companies need to be able to adjust, and living with what you had in the past is not gonna be sufficient for the future.
Talking about innovation, where do you think which kind of innovations will have the greatest impact on our lives in the next future, in your opinion?
Well, certainly in the automotive world, there's going to be a lot of innovation. And I think, you know, autonomous systems, I think, probably come at the very top in terms of how they're going to impact. Imagine the impact on the senior population, right? The ability to be able to still move when you're not able to drive anymore. I mean, that would be tremendous. I mean, from a societal standpoint, would be a massive change, right? In our space, in the technology world, clearly, augmented reality and virtual reality are technologies that will find commercial application. They're not ready today. They might be ready 3 or 5 years from now. But if you think about, and you probably have had some experience with some demos on virtual reality, the potential application of virtual reality for sectors like education, for example, right? Being able to bring students into, like, if you're studying, I don't know, the Roman Empire, and being able to be there, right, to be present there, with travel, with gaming, there's a lot of applications that lend themselves very, very well to virtual reality and augmented reality. So I think that's clearly an area that will bring a lot of change to the way that people live their lives, right? And the other big one that, of course, is much more current now is this concept of artificial intelligence and machine learning, and the ability to process volumes of data that were not even thinkable just a few years ago, and what that is going to mean in the field of research, in the field of just in so many aspects of life, right? Being able to process that information. So I would say these three are probably the biggest one.
Italians, too, have made important contributions to the history of technology innovation, from the P101 by Olivetti in 1965, that we celebrated a couple of years ago here with an exhibition, to Federico Faggin, the first microchip at Intel in 1971, Arduino, 2005, the open source platform for prototyping and the new manufacturing. Do you think that Italians still have something to say in the digital industry?
Yeah, I think if your question is around individuals, I really believe that you know, Italians can be, you know, great contributors. That there is absolutely no doubt, and we have a lot of examples around the world still today. And as I said, I think the foundation, the educational system is there, and the Italian creativity is there to allow that. I'm a bit more skeptical around the ability for an Italian company to actually drive some of this innovation, because, not because, again, Italians are not capable of doing this, but because I think Silicon Valley has become such an incredible attraction in the technology world that the infrastructure is there, right? I mean, the availability of capital to start with, right? I think the biggest issue for Italian startups is the availability of capital, right? And you go to Silicon Valley, and if you have a great idea, you're going to get it funded. There's no doubt there, right? The availability of talent. There's a concentration of great universities in California that make the hiring of great, you know, great kids, you know, so much easier. And so the infrastructure is there, to the point that I was reading the other day that about half of all the startups in Silicon Valley have foreign national founders. So the about half of the startups that are founded in Silicon Valley, not founded by Americans, but they're founded by Italians, Indians, Chinese people, and so on, right? So I think clearly Italians can provide great contributions. I think, you know, Silicon Valley has really created a competitive advantage from a location standpoint, that if you have a great idea, and I know a lot of great Italian guys that have built their businesses out of Silicon Valley, and then actually they end up using engineering resources in Italy, right?
Yeah, it's a very common model, yeah. Having a company in Silicon Valley or in the US, and then having engineers and software developers in Italy. Yeah. Anyway, do you know any Italian startup?
Yeah.
And what do you think of the attitude of the founders of Italian startups towards risk creativity?
For us, you know, Apple has this incredible window over the startup world, because the App Store has become this great platform for people to come up with great ideas and make them available to a global audience very quickly, right? And therefore, you know, we have this view all over the world of what is happening in, you know, particularly with app development. And in Italy, we got a lot of great examples. I know a couple of them extremely well, because I know the founders. I know the guys that run Music Smash, for example, that is the biggest lyrics catalog in the world, and I'm actually very proud that now they've started a direct collaboration with us, with Apple Music. I know the person that runs, that founded Kurami. Kurami is this great app, which I think is perfect for Italy, but is already finding contracts around the world, which essentially allows you to skip the line. Instead of...
That's typical Italian.
In a constructive way, in the sense that, for example, if you need to go to the hospital, instead of standing in line at the hospital to get your appointment, you can actually do it online with Kurami, and so they tell you exactly, you need to show up at the hospital at 8:45, and you know, essentially you go there and you avoid the physical line, right? For the public administration, it's great. They got an important contract with the Royal Mail in the UK, for example, to do that. And when I talk to them, it's always, I mean, the issue is not actually, the Italian creativity is a huge advantage, right? I mean, you can come up with great ideas on the App Store. You can make them happen, even with a small group of people. The two bottlenecks the three. The issue is raising capital, raising capital. Clearly, Italy is a relatively small capital market, and so there's not a lot of money going around. The second one is availability of engineering talent. And this is the fundamental reason why we decided to make an investment in Naples to launch this training center. Because the guy, the founder of Kurami was telling me, you know, my biggest problem right now that I'm growing is to have enough app developers that come, want to come and work for me. There's not enough of them. And so this is going to create a bit of an engine for developers to help them as they grow. And the third one is, you know, a bit of the bureaucracy that is around, you know, the business world in Italy, right? That there's a bit, that, that's a bit of common denominator for not only for startups, but I think for every enterprise.
So you said that in practice a new Steve Jobs could be born in Italy.
No, there's not. And as I said, half of the founders of these startups today in the United States is not American. So the likelihood that it can be coming from a different country, and as I said, you know, Italy with all the creativity that we have, I think it definitely can be the case.
Apart from the technology industry, in which other industries do you think that Italian entrepreneurs can compete successfully on the global market?
You know, this is something that I have a very simplistic view of the world, and I've learned that, you know, you can spend your life working on your strengths, or you can spend your life working on your weaknesses. And I think it's much more productive at some point just to work on your strengths, because the multiplier is much higher, right? And so I've been away from Italy for so many years that maybe I'm missing something, but I continue to believe that if in Italy we focused on the things that we do really, really well, I think it would be much better than trying to do things that for a variety of reasons are not necessarily going to be successful. So we are great at design, from industrial design to interior design. We're great in fashion, we're great at food, we're great in general, artisanship, right? This concept of artigianato. We're not great at making the most. We are really good at making the best, which is, by the way, the recipe at Apple, right? I really believe that, and Tim Cook has the same view. You know, he opened the academic year at Bocconi a year ago, and he said the same thing. You know, when he thinks about, he's a biker, when he thinks about buying a bike, he always thinks about Italian bikes because they are the best bikes in the world. If we try to do something that requires scale, I don't personally believe that we're going to be very successful at it, right? Because there are other places in the world that can do scale much better than Italy for millions of reasons, right? But it pains me to see that, for example, when I go to Florence and I look at these amazing, you know, artisan shops that we have that go from jewelry to furniture, and I go into these labs and I see people that are as old as me, and that's not good. We need younger people to be doing those things, because that's where we excel. Very simplistic view. I don't think I will ever be the, you know, in charge of economic development in Italy, but I think there's some truth to that.
And that goes back again to the relationship between education and the workplace, right?
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely, absolutely. And exactly, you know, creating those connections, I think, would be incredibly important.
Being an Italian, has helped you in your global career, or have you had to fight against the stereotypes about Italians?
To me, it's been a huge asset because having lived all over the world, I don't think that there's any other country that attracts so much affection from foreigners as Italy. Mm-hmm. Anybody that, you know, you can live. If you're in Brazil and you're Italian, you consider like God, right? But if you live in Germany, I mean, I've had German friends, you know, just with tears in their eyes talking about their vacation to Italy, right? And I think the affection for the country is unparalleled, and I don't think there's any other country that attracts this level of affection. I think we as Italians create our own stereotypes, and I really believe that we sometimes convince ourselves that there is, for example, a glass ceiling that we cannot break because we are Italian. I was the first one, and to think that I will never be able to have this job at General Motors because I'm not American, and my wife, that is American, was always telling me, no, actually, you don't understand, right? Because particularly working for American companies, they are so inclusive that is never gonna be the issue. I've never seen, you know, anything that has been a negative for me being Italian. I think it's been a massive plus.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's good.
So you've been away from Italy for, you said, how many years?
Almost 30 years now. Yeah. Yeah, 20, 25.
Have you ever thought of going back to live and work in Italy? I'm thinking of a colleague of yours, Diego Piacentini.
Diego is a saint. he's a saint. But
he left Amazon, and he used to be also a top manager with Apple in Europe, right?
Yeah. He used to run Europe for Apple, and then he moved to a very, very successful career at Amazon.
Yeah. So he left for a sabbatical for 2 years, working in Rome at the new digital team, the government.
Yeah.
Would you consider such a position or any other of that kind?
First of all, to the initial question, when I don't work anymore, I'm gonna have a split life where we're gonna be spending some time here in the US, and definitely I'm gonna be spending several months in Italy. I really like my job, and so I think for now I think I'm gonna do this. This idea of giving back to Italy, I think is something that is very appealing. And when I talk to people that have had global careers, I think it's very uniform that, you know, if we could find a way to give back, obviously I would have to be an opportunity where I feel I can contribute something, right? But certainly I would consider it, not today or tomorrow, but I would consider it. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Well, I would stop here for the time being and open to questions from the audience. One warning: we're not talking about Apple's strategies. I mean, you.
Oh, you can ask.
You can ask, and he can not answer. So, who wants to ask the first question?
I have concluded that there are many more CFOs in American companies than there are with Italian names than there are CEOs and CFOs. What may account for that? Certainly not the fact that they have received a humanistic education in Italy.
So you're saying more CFOs than CEOs?
Oh, by far.
Mm-hmm. Could be. We have our head of both hardware engineering and software engineering are American people with an Italian name. Their families are from Italy. But you know that accounting was created in Italy, right? And goes back to the Venetian Empire. But I don't know. I think again, this is one of the stereotypes that Italians are not good at managing money, and maybe we're actually a bit better than what. Than what people say, but there are a lot of CEOs of very large companies. I mean, the CEO of Bristol Myers here in New Jersey is an Italian guy, right?
Yeah. By the way, Caforio will be the next guest of our series of conversation, March the 9th.
Don't ask him that question, right?
You may detect from my accent that I'm from Rome too, but not a fan of Juventus. a question not particularly pertinent to Apple's strategy, but your choice to go to Apple. Yeah. You went to Apple in a very distinct moment of certainly your career, apparently, but certainly of their strategy. What attracted you there, and what surprised you in what you found there?
Yeah, it's a really good question. To me, it was the process that I went through as part of the interview going into Apple. For me, was very revealing because the fear that I had going into Apple was the potential that the company might have become complacent because of the incredible success that they had, right? And particularly with Steve's passing, you know, what this would mean to Apple as a company. I was a bit concerned about that because I worked for companies that were great in the past, but then they were not able to renew themselves. And when I went through this interview, I actually met a management team that you could tell they were incredibly consumed by the success of the company, wanting the companies to be successful and being so passionate about what they were doing. I'm a bit of a perfectionist, and Apple is really the representation of, you know, pursuing perfection and excellence in everything that we do. And so I felt it was a very, very natural fit for me, and that process removed the concerns. And what I learned there, and this is my view of Apple after having spent a few years there, is that the perception that people have of Apple from the outside cannot necessarily be what in reality the company is. I think people in general view Apple as this great center of innovation and creativity, which obviously it is. But working at Apple for me feels like it's a hybrid of working for the army, because it's truly an incredible execution machine. I mean, for us to be able to deliver to our customers the volume of products that we deliver requires a flawless execution, right? And so it's a bit of working for an army. And I felt, particularly in the beginning, I felt like being in a monastery, because this concept of serving the company as opposed to expressing your ego is very, very important at Apple. If you have a very strong ego and personality at Apple, it's unlikely, unless your name is Steve Jobs, it's unlikely that you're gonna be very successful, right? The team works as a team, and you're there to serve the company, and that is very important. And again, it fits very well my personality, so for me it was great.
Silicon Valley is famous for being the land of the optimists, right? Mm-hmm. And I was very shocked to read last week on the New Yorker a piece citing many venture capitalists and tech investors who have become billionaires or millionaires who are preparing for the end of the world, buying homes in New Zealand or in silos for anti-nuclear weapons somewhere on the West Coast. Can you tell us what's your feeling, your sense of the dominant feeling in Silicon Valley in the current political environment?
Well, it is very clear that what's happened over the last year or so, not only here in the United States, but in Europe, for example, and in Asia to a certain extent as well, clearly there's a sense that there's a lot of volatility, right, in the environment, and therefore if you have a bit of a pessimistic view of the world, then you get to the conclusion that you need to buy a bunker and hide there. That's clearly not the view that we have at Apple. We really think that the best possible outcome in these uncertain times is to engage. And I think the companies today are in a great position to engage with governments to try and influence the outcome. Now, you may not agree necessarily with everything that any given government is bringing forward as an agenda, but it's much better to stand up and say something as opposed to being silent or preparing for the end of the world. I think we have the opportunity, particularly a company like the size of Apple, we think we have the opportunity to establish a dialogue and hopefully influence the outcome. So we are not building bunkers, we're not developing contingency plans for the end of the world.
If you're like a consumer product like Uber, you get punished. Like Travis Kalanick had to leave the company. economic commission of the government because he was being Uber was being boycotted from consumers.
I think you need to, again, in these situations, I think you need to be, and I cannot speak for Uber, but I would say that I think there is a lot of rhetoric around the world. I mean, the position the situation that we've had to live in Europe with Brussels and this view that we owe the Irish government $13 billion. I mean, that's a punishment, right? It's an absurd punishment because the Irish government doesn't want that money, right? And so all of a sudden there is, you know, a structure that it doesn't even have tax jurisdiction deciding for one of the member states what the right law should have been in the past and apply retroactively. These are things that I think companies need to accept that's a possible outcome, and therefore, again, you need to try as much as possible to engage and be part of that dialogue and try to fight those battles.
Luca, Apple stands for innovation. I think nobody would argue with that. I was just thinking, is there anything that you do with a corporate office, anything in the way that you work that you think is different from any other Fortune 100 company that distinguishes the way that you go about your work?
I think there are some differences. I think that, and I cannot speak for all the other 99 companies, right? But certainly based on my past experience in other large multinationals, we are a company of very strong values. And in certain cases, we make decisions that have nothing to do with the financial return. And, you know, this may scare some of our investors at times. But we believe that we do what is right and not necessarily what is convenient. And so there are some areas where we decide to make a lot of investments because we think it's right for society at large and it's right for our consumers in general. For example, some of the investments that we make in the environment, we're running all our offices around the world now 100% on renewable energy. And that obviously required a number of investments that don't have immediate payback, but we think it's the right thing to do. So we got this, you know, very strong view around values. The other thing that I think is different is that, for example, we always believe that quality is more important than quantity. And so, for example, we run the company very lean. I tell my guys in finance, I don't want you guys to ever benchmark anybody else because you can only get bad ideas. We run the finances of Apple with about half the size of some of the companies that I worked for before. They were like a tenth the size of Apple, right? I have an investor relations group of two people. I have the group that manages $230 billion of cash is a group of seven. I know when I look at my counterparts in other large companies, they've got multiples of those resources, but we really believe that if we have the right people, we don't need a lot of them. And so I think that's a different way. The other thing that is really, really, really different from most other companies is that we are, as a management team, we are incredibly hands-on. We get together every Monday morning for 3 or 4 hours and talk about all the programs that we got going on, the top 10 guys in the company, and we get into a level of detail that I don't think any other company, probably people would laugh if they know what we talk about during that meeting. But it's again this concept of perfection, and perfection is in the details, it's not at the 30,000 feet level strategy, right? And so I think that we run the company in very differently and in a very centralized way. For us, truly, Cupertino is the center of the universe, but for Apple, right? And a lot of, you know, almost all of the decisions are made there. We're not decentralized in any meaningful way. So there are, you know, I don't think there's ever going to be a perfect organizational structure. We've made a decision that we run Apple centrally, based on functional excellence, and that's the way we run it.
Hello.
Yeah. I'm Domenico Romano. I work for Natuzzi. So sure. I'm more or less artisanal company.
Yeah.
In my life, I used to work for a real estate company as McDonald's, agriculture company as Whole Foods here, and the cosmetic company as L'Oreal, and now in Natuzzi. All these companies are like a core business or as a main asset, the product. I was always scary about the high-tech because, you know, you are a CFO and you got to ask for your investor to invest in a company that has a product that in 6 months is already old. Which one is your main asset for Apple? Which yeah. one is the core business, the real core business of Apple, if you cannot talk about product?
I think we understand very well, particularly looking at other companies in the tech world that were dominant just 10 years ago and they are no longer in business. It is very, very clear that the recipe is not a specific product, but is our platform. Is our ability to integrate hardware, software, and services. It's the ecosystem, right? Because that's what attracts you as a consumer to come back to us. It's not necessarily the next version of the iPhone, but the fact that with the next version of the iPhone, you get the new software upgrade for free, and you get improved services all the time. And when you look at the technology world, we are the only company that does that. The Android world is really Google providing software and services and a number of excellent manufacturing companies providing the products. But by doing that, you don't have the level of integration between hardware engineering and software engineering that we can do because we do everything under the same umbrella. So for example, an experience like Apple Pay, which requires not only the software, the sensors for it, but also requires a component within the phone, is something that it's essentially impossible to replicate, right? And so we are working on this iOS platform to make sure that it becomes more and more relevant for you every time, you know, we come out with a new product, right? Which means more services, better experience, better integration between hardware and software, so that your decision to buy the next iPhone is not only related to the iPhone itself. And we are very fortunate, and I think that's our biggest asset, that when we look at our loyalty rates, they're above 90%, right? And we know that the Android world is not that loyal. And so that makes the big difference. That's, if you ask me, the key is the integration between hardware, software, and services.
Two very brief, quick questions. The first one, if Apple has a policy to hire a several management or top executive level people with disabilities, especially autism or the use in coding and other activity. The second one is if you can tell us more about the investment with the Federico II University in Naples, if it continues, how it's structured, and basically which is the outcome that Apple expect from this project. Thank you.
I'm glad you asked the question about disabilities. We call it accessibility. And we think accessibility is important in terms of hiring for us because it really allows us to fully understand what needs to be done from a product perspective. So we got a lot of engineers with disabilities from being blind to other type of disabilities in our organization because they are, you know, the best people that can help us be excellent at that. And we put a lot of resources into the development of accessibility features within our products. So it's a very important priority for us. On Federico II, as I said earlier, the main objective for us is to create a developer community that is vibrant in Italy. And we already, there's a lot of around a lot of people that have actually built their businesses around iOS and around the App Store, and we want to make sure that there is a pipeline of talent that comes through on a regular basis. So the metric for success for us is, first of all, that these kids that go through the program have a wonderful experience. And the initial feedback that we get in the first, we brought in the first 100 students in October, and so now they've done just a few months. And we just started the second wave of another 100 students at the end of January, and we went out and got the feedback from the first wave, and they're all ecstatic with the experience. So that, for us, number one is having, you know, great experience for the people that go through the program. And the second one, which to me is particularly important, is that when they come out of this program, they actually, that they have real opportunities, either to start working on their app, if they have a great idea, or to find a job for any company that is interested in that type of skill set. So if we're able to meet those fundamental objectives, I keep telling within Apple, don't underestimate some of the challenges that you have to start something new in Italy. But if things go well, certainly we could consider doing something similar somewhere else in Italy. But we want to go step by step.
First of all, thank you for your time tonight. As a question, what would your message and suggestion be for those young Italians, like many of us here, that already took the step to come to the United States for a professional career?
Yeah, but I think you're already halfway there, to be honest, in the sense that the opportunities that you have here are, you know, are unlimited, essentially, right? And so you're already in the right environment. You already, obviously, having been able to get here, you've got the right level of education, the right level of ambition, the willingness to take risks. So all these things, you already checked all the boxes. And so I would tell you at this point is, sometimes, particularly if you work for a large corporation, there's a risk of getting lost in the system because they are large. And so it's not a given that you're going to become successful just because you work for a large company. Really, really try to understand deep inside what drives you. What is your passion? And if you really find something that really, when you wake up in the morning, you're really, really excited about, you're going to be successful.
Can I?
Il romanista.
Okay. Posso?
Poi possiamo fare tutte e due, dai, facciamo tutte e due. Facciamo
allora,
tutte.
Posso fare a little bit more of a macro question. No, there's probably a few companies like Apple who have a real view of what is happening in the world. Mm. Even though we live in the United States and now we think this is the center of the world, the real world has actually moved east a long, long, long time ago. No,
yeah.
You are just starting to penetrate India. You have a very ongoing campaign in China. Now, what's your view of that part of the world?
Yeah, it's clearly... I mean, you need to look at it at different levels. I always start with the demographics, right? I read a statistics that says in 2050, 60% of the world is going to be either Indian or Chinese. So if you don't pay attention to India and China, you're really, you know, way off base, right? And so that's the reality. You're right. The center of gravity, when you look at it in terms of trade flows, has gone back to China and India. It used to be like that from, you know, year one to year 1500, right? And then it started moving, but it's gone back there. And those are very powerful forces that we need to keep in mind. And I think what American companies have done very well is recognize that part of the world is very, very important. And sometimes when I go to Europe, I feel that the concept of Asia is still not there, right? And people do not quite understand what is happening. So clearly it's a part of the world that is incredibly important. They've got the demographics to support levels of growth that I don't think we're going to be able to replicate in Europe. And so that's the way we think about it. We also think about the fact that if the world continues to be a place where talent and goods can move freely, I think it's a better world for everybody. We're making our views known to everybody that's willing to listen.
Thank you again for your time tonight. I just wanted to ask you, you mentioned social responsibility earlier, and I was wondering if Apple is involved in social investing, and if not, if you have plans to expand in that direction at some point, maybe through a foundation or something.
Yeah, that's a great question, and it's not the history of the company to have a foundation per se, but we have picked over the years a number of themes where we feel that we need to play a role. And in some cases, we play a role directly ourselves. In other cases, and we think it's the most productive way of doing this, is to do this in collaboration with government institutions. Because I think, again, the multiplier is much, much larger. We decided that it's important for us to participate in environmental initiatives. We do it for our own facilities. We are doing it in a number of places around the world, starting with China, in collaboration with the local governments. We're doing, and this is part of the DNA of the company, we're doing an incredible amount of work around education. We've got this initiative going on in the United States called Connect Ed that essentially provides technology solutions for underserved schools. This was an initiative that was started by the Obama administration, and it's something that we feel privileged to be part of, because I think it's, again, in terms of supporting society, I think we think it's very important. So we don't have a foundation per se, but there are a number of themes from environment to education to human rights to accessibility where we feel that we need to play our part.
Great. I think it has been an incredibly interesting conversation. So I thank Luca for his time, and thank you for your attention.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you again. Grazie. I think you have showed you are a truly Italian Renaissance man with the heart, soul, and brains. Grazie mille. And now for everybody, we have some light drinks, snacks by Urbani Tartufi, another Italian excellence.
Grazie mille. Grazie. 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 Grazie.